share an epic bar tour with us. So, without further ado, Mordechai.
I wanted to actually just congratulate Yona and Jakob. You guys just have done a great job over this Bon Hazman, and it's just so much Kedusha, just keeping the guys together, keeping them engaged, and creating that platform for them to go into this next Zaman and feeling excited and refreshed. And it was such a huge zechut, like, to do that. I just want to give them a round of applause. Hey. Yeah. An idea for the future, and most times when people have ideas or visions for the future, you know, it's kind of like coming from their own thing, you know, something that they're passionate about. But I want to give an idea for the future, but I want to connect it to a Torah proof. So that's the idea. So, you know, we're learning yeshiva and this whole thing, we're learning Torah, but, you know, in the outside world, in the Gashmius, you know, that world, the world is going through tremendous changes, you know, tremendous changes. And most of these changes are from technology. And, you know, they're saying, like, robot technology is removing, like, close to 80% of the workforce, meaning that jobs that we would normally go to school and get a degree and go and get a job for are now being done by robots. And all the way to, if you have a high school diploma and you want to work at a McDonald's, now there's automation, there's machines that are there. If you wanted to be a lawyer, you know, now they have artificial intelligence that are providing legal solutions. If you wanted to be a doctor, do surgeries, there's now machines that are inside doing the medical procedures. And so the question is, you know, where does this leave us, and why has Hashem created such a reality that in America, they're saying over the next 10 years, close to 50 million jobs are going to be gone because of robot technology and global outsourcing. Like, where does that leave us? What's going on? And what's the new economy? Like, what's the new vision for the economy? And so the economists have been calling it the idea-based economy. They've been talking about this since the 70s because they knew robot technology. And if you guys don't remember, and I don't necessarily remember, but I do a lot of research in history. If you look, they had all these movies in the 70s and the 60s, Rabbi Zweig made, and it was about the robots and the humans and the battles. So they were predicting this huge challenge that, you know, humanity was going to be faced with. And so they're saying now that the new era that we're going into is called the idea-based economy. So what is this idea-based economy? The idea-based economy is where individuals and groups contribute ideas and concepts that improve other people's lives. And they're saying that is the new basis of the economy, meaning that, like, we're all in this room together, and so we're saying that us collectively, all we have an asset, we have brain power, we have excitement, we have, you know, we have knowledge of history, mathematics, whatever it is. So in this new economy, we would come together, we would sit together, and then we would figure out who's good at what, and then we would figure out how can we package that and sell it and bring it to other people, whether it's through economic cash exchange or through bartering. And so that idea is a profound concept for people who are learning in yeshiva. Why? Because if we're saying we're in an idea-based economy, that means we have to know how to use our brains, and we have to use our minds, and we have to know how to have critical thought, and we have to know how to analyze. And we have to know how to contextualize. And when you look at all these sefers that we have in this room, these have been the best conceptual thinkers on planet Earth, have been the Jewish rabbis. And so when we're here learning in yeshiva, we're not just learning the laws about, you know, tzitzit and in terms of connecting to the mitzvah, which Jakob did a tremendous job. I came to one of his shiurs, it was really great, and the guys were really inspired by it. But we're learning the depth and the expression of God's will, which is the Torah. So how do I prove what I'm saying to you? How do I prove that the future of the world, the future of the economy, is based off of our ability to think in these new, creative, and innovative ways to save our lives? So I'm going to use the story of Yosef HaTzadik, And I'm going to close it out with this. The Torah, it says Yosef HaTzadik, when there was a famine going on in Egypt, that the entire world, all the nations of the world came to Egypt. And when they came to Egypt, they wanted grain. You know, Yosef wanted them to circumcise themselves, and he went back and forth to the Pharaoh, and, you know, all these different things. But on a literal level, it's a story about Yosef being in prison and rising to power and in essence, saving the whole world from this famine. But if we look at it from a different perspective, and we look at Yosef being the expression of the Jewish people, and the Jewish people going through, being in this galus and going through all these difficulties and hatred and Lashon Hara, and people misunderstanding us and misunderstanding God in essence. But at a point in history, that's going to stop. And I think being in the Teretz Israel and living here is part of that beginning of it stopping. And Yosef gets out of prison, and the Jewish people leave this prison of judgment in the Goshenist world, and we're able to rise to a position of power. Now, our job is not to be the rulers of the world. It's not about that. You know, you can say, you have America. If they want to have military power and be the rulers of the world, you got America for that. So in this context, America is the Pharaoh. Yosef HaTzadik is the Jewish people. And so when we think about the famine, it doesn't just mean grain. It could be a world that has given up on materialism, a world that's given up on the American dream. What does that mean? That means the white picket fence and the cat and the dog is not going to make me happy. You know, having these material items is not going to fulfill me. And so I'm done with it. I'm over with it. And so the whole world is in this spiritual drought where they're suffering and they're in pain in the same way as the Torah explains to us, and we see it from a standpoint of grain. But what is grain? Grain is something that we plant, that harvests, that creates food, and it fills us. But if it's spiritually, we don't have any grain. We're totally empty. We've given up on materialism. So what happens? The nations of the world, what do? They go to the world superpower. They go to America, and they say, America, please save us. We're empty. We don't know what to do. We want to follow your dream. And you know what the Pharaoh said? Go and talk to Yosef. Go and talk to the Jewish people. Because I don't know. It hasn't worked for me either. And if it wasn't for the Jewish people, I wouldn't even be here where I'm at right now. So go and talk to Yosef. Go and talk to the Jewish people. And so when they go and talk to the Jewish people explain to them how they have to elevate themselves. And they have to transform themselves. And the world eventually starts to listen to the Jewish people. And as the Torah tells us, is that when the nations went to Yosef, when they listened to Yosef, not only did Yosef remove the famine that they were having in their lives, but then the famine in the entire world. So when you think about the land of Israel, the land of Israel isn't about being like America. It's about being a spiritual headquarters for the planet Earth. And the Jewish people giving grain, giving sustenance, inspiration for life for all the nations. The Torah is showing us this specifically. It's showing us this specifically in the story of Yosef. And so as we learn in Yeshiva, we continue to grow, you know, may we have the Kavana and the thought process that it's not just about, I want to improve myself and I want to be a tremendous father and I want to be a tremendous part of my community, which is true, but we're in the Messianic era where we're building a new reality for humanity, and every Jew is needed. Every Jew is needed. Every bit of Torah that we're learning is the grain that the entire world is counting on.
Joshua. Wow.